Go take a photograph of this one.
During that restoration process, they went through the whole thing with a fine tooth and figured out what the problem was with the boiler. So what it had to do with the drafting in the front. Do you know how drafting works?
Well, sucking, yeah.
You've got steam from the cylinder, yeah. And to what's called a blast pipe.
Yeah.
And it
goes into that.
Only room for one
Sorry.
We'll then move the Peckett onto the turntable and join him up with the trucks, and he'll go to run up the yard parallel to the
Thank you.
Have you cleared the exit then? Thank you. The passenger train's running, nobody has actually arrived with the coal tank. Clear of the entry road, please, folks. While people are taking photographs and artists are working, don't forget.
Thank you. Well, we're just asleep. We weren't giving up.
Beans on it.
Circus ringmaster.
Right, we'll leave it there for 5 or 10 minutes and you can take your shot. Your feet are sticking out, they will be chopped off by the railings going past, and we don't have an ambulance.
Thank you. feet. Peckett will come to where I'm standing over here, so don't stand on this track here, because this is where we will end up. We're going to try and keep this brief. Okay, that's probably the funniest thing I'm going to say. I'm Les Ross, and your question is, who? I am standing up, by the way. For those that don't know, because I know you've come from far and wide, international travellers, some people have come from West Bromwich. So, lovely to be here at Tyseley today. And not for the first time. Very quickly, the story of this locomotive, not from 1965, but from when I got to know it, is I presented the breakfast show on BRMB Radio in the West Midlands for 26 years. And you don't get that for murder, as they say. So on the day I was leaving, I wasn't sacked, it was voluntary. What I didn't know was that one of my regular esteemed listeners had rung up the radio station and said, what are you going to do for Les when he leaves? And they said, we're going to throw a party. We're not inviting him, but we're going to throw a party. And this listener, called Ellie, said, why don't you, knowing I was a railway enthusiast, why don't you get Virgin Trains, because they used to advertise on my programme. Fools, look what happened to them. Anyway, she said, why don't you get Virgin Trains to name an engine after him? Well, as if anybody had taken that up as a suggestion. So they did. And that lady who had the mad idea, Ellie, happens to be, I hope, in this cab. Ellie, we've rehearsed this. Where are you? Thank you. You've got to lean out a bit. That's how windows work. There you are. How are you? Are you all right? Oh, I thought the mic had reached. Right. Let me just say. Have you got a few words to say about why you came up with this mad idea?
I just thought, so much of business, over the years, in the world. And I thought, train is every other word we said. So I don't know. What would he love? We have to have some local named after. So I put it to the IRB and never expected anything to come from it. It was just a germ of an idea which was going to this type of code. So it really, I feel if I haven't really done very much, but I'm better at this than me.
I didn't care to say anymore anyway. Thank you, Ellie, that was lovely. I know that's difficult, not everybody's very good on the microphone, including me. So thank you, Ellie. So she is one of the people to blame for all this. The other person, anyway, the loco then ran on the West Coast Main Line with Virgin Trains for a year or so, and then they decided they'd had enough of it, so they withdrew it and replaced it with those lovely Pendolinos. And the loco went to the store and was probably doomed. Well, we all are eventually, aren't we? And I was I'm still a volunteer here at Tyseley, and I bemoaned the fact that my loco was really not operating anymore. It wasn't my loco, but the one named after me. And I talked to the boss man down here at Tyseley. I don't know what kind of conversation we had. I can't remember, but. You can. Well, I'll tell you what, the boss man down here at Tyseley, and he's still here, leaning nonchalantly on the rail here, is Mr. Bob Meanley, and he can probably tell you a little bit more about how we got this far. So, a few words from the other person to blame for all this, Bob Meanley.
I really wish that I'd made a book for the other being not very good on the microphone in the We all knew about Virgin Trains naming this locomotive Les Ross, and the circumstances around it, actually. What happened was that they actually promised Les a ride on three times.
Yes!
And every time he went, it had gone somewhere else. So he never actually got a ride on it, even though he claimed after it. And one morning he came in my office, the conversation went something to the effect that I'd been withdrawn.
What?
I've withdrawn and it's still in Stonebridge Park Depot. What's going to happen to me? Oh, that. Well, you can't get broke, won't they? No, I've had this silly idea. And from there on, you knew what was coming. So, Les said, well, could we sort of look after the people a bit? Yeah, I was fancy having one of those in the collection. And so we entered a bit of a protracted discussion with the owners at that time, who were HSBC Rail, and they were putting it in storage, what we could term secure storage in England. Now, secure storage consisted of being shunted out of the shed periodically by a fork truck, who, they were getting fork trucks through body size and windows and all sorts of things. And eventually, HSBC decided that it wasn't quite as secure as they thought. And we sort of broke the deal where they sent it here in return for us not charging it for storage. And when we got it, very fortunate, we got several people around us who knew a bit about 86s, including my long-term friend Andrew Taylor here. And with a lot of advice and a lot of looking at, we decided it was actually quite a good locomotive. Now, when you think these things were built in 1964-66, I have to admit I first saw the first bulb being built at Doncaster. They were just about the first locomotives that were built in this nation, rather than 100 miles an hour, and then 100 miles an hour into city services. And this particular one has carried on doing that for almost 40 years. And in that 40 years, it did just over 6 million miles. The fact that it's still the same locomotive, still the same transformer, same traction motor, and the same bogies with just a little bit of change to the spring, because after a few years they found out that they were actually knocking the track apart. They did a lot of modifications to sort of stop them demolishing the track. And they're very, very successful locos. When you think that, you know, Les bought this and it's still a very effective frontline express passenger locomotive, it has to be amongst the very best of locomotives that we've ever built in this country. And, you know, I've always referred to them as electric duchesses, but I think they're the first sort of passive loco that we developed that were worthy successors to the LNWR duchesses. Great pleasure to get involved in actually making this go. One of my colleagues here, Dave Fisher, who at that time was Network Rail's fleet engineer for the small number of routes which they had, put a lot into it, which was Thompson, a lot of the other guys here, a few people outside as well, including the staff of Oxford Depot, who finally sort of checked it out and made sure it was safe to plug into the mains. And the rest is really history. What we were proud of is that at the time we got it going, we became the first organisation since British Railways in 1968 to have steam, diesel and electric locomotives registered to operate on the national network. And as a steam network, we're actually quite proud of that. But, you know, it's gone on with the West Coast Railways operating.
That's all right. I've got another paper round. Thank you, Bob. I need you, Bob, to say that. Well, not that last bit, but most of it. And so this is it. This is A6259, spiritual heritage home, as I call it. In the last 4 or 5 years, the Loco's gone to live at Wilsdon Depot on the West Coast Rail Line, just outside Euston. And actually, the man who is basically responsible—he's just got back in. Come out of there, David Green. Yeah. David Green from Wilsdon, who's come down here to talk to all you people who wanted to come through the camps today. He's the man who actually basically looks after it now for me at Wilsdon. He knows a bit about it, so there you are. Thank you very much, David, for that. Yeah, give him a round of applause. Because they have other things to do. They've got quite a lot of locos and trains to look after there. So, you know, as long as this one's the most important, that's all that matters, really, isn't it? Other thank yous. By the way, I forgot, Ellie. Now you've got the lean just right now, look. Give them a little wave. That's it. Marvellous. Forgot to give you your bouquet. It's not... Here, grab that. That's what I said to the Queen the last time I gave her a bouquet. Right. There we are. Thank you, Ellie. Now, what are we here for? Oh, yeah, we're going to name it. That's right. I've forgotten. I knew there was something. Now, this loco was, its first name was Peter Pan, and not 50 years ago, the loco is now exactly 50 years old. They weren't named for a dozen years or so, and this was one of the first of its class to be named, and the competition was run to choose a name. And a young man, aged 6 I think, called Ian Hull, chose the name Peter Pan in a national competition. It was the International Year of the Child in 1979, so that was an appropriate name, Peter Pan being child associated, the boy that never grew up. That counts most of us. And in fact, I admit, I tried to find Ian Hull, who's now aged 42, to come and name the loco Peter Pan again. And after about a dozen Miss Marples were on the case, including my friend Mark there and one or two other people who are here today, we found out he's probably emigrated. So he must have heard I wanted him to unveil the name. We need a young person, don't we? We need a young man. You know, it's all about young people. Have we got a young man who can do this naming here today? Anybody close by? You'll do. What's your name?
Jacob.
And do you know, have you ever driven this loco?
No, not
before. Do you know anybody who has?
Dad.
Your dad? Oh, right. Oh, is that your dad? What a coincidence. Okay. So, yes, Andy is very instrumental. Well, he's driven this loco a lot, let's put it like that. And so I thought, well, Jacob can do it. Jake can do it. Can't you? Have you unveiled the loco name before? And I never have, so you're about to be in one up on me already. So, would you like to do the honours? Okay. Yeah, okay. Okay, come this way. It's down here. Now, I have spent weeks designing this cover and then constructing it, so it better work. All you have to do, Jake, is do you want to say any other words before you pull the ribbon?
Ladies and gentlemen, I am proud to be named this engine Peter Pan, and thank you to Les for inviting me today.
Well, brilliant. Give a round of applause now. Now, just give that a pull. Well, oh, the tape stayed on, didn't it? I knew it would. Oh, the design is terrible. Brilliant, Jake. Give him a big round of applause.
From all that, that it's also Peter Pan's birthday today, and our impeccable Peter Pan, Mr. Ross, has very kindly produced a birthday cake for it. So as you leave and go by, when he's found the cake and got it out, he'll be delighted to give you a wee piece.
Excellent. Now we're going to move the picket backwards across the crossing. So if you're around the area between George V and City of Truro, you're in the way. So please stand back so the picket can safely go between them and couple back up to its wagons. And then we're going to bring Rood Ashton Hall down and turn it round to get ready for the locomotive cavalcade, which will be the next attraction. We've already stopped running the passenger train, which is sitting at the top of the yard waiting to come off the demonstration line as soon as we are ready to receive it. So we're going to lose the Peckett, welcome the hall, take 9600 out of the turntable row and put it in the middle between the hall and Princess Elizabeth. That'll take a few minutes, so again, please don't hold on to the turntable because you go around with it.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, I'm pretty sad.
Yeah. You are good.
Thank you.
I'll go down there, I'll go.